Thank you. Dear Father, we come into thy presence with gladness. We come into thy presence with joy. We come into thy presence with peace. We come into thy presence with thanksgiving for the way that has been made for us. The prophets foretold that a way would be open unto the throne of God. And we rejoice today in the shed blood of Christ, in the perfect sacrifice of our Lord that has not only availed for our sins, but given us entry into his presence and opened up our lives that he may dwell within for eternity. We thank thee for eternal life. We thank thee, Lord, for temporary life here on earth. And we thank thee for the beauty that we see around us. We thank thee for the beauty of thy people, for those who've been purchased by the blood of Christ today, and with them, looking to thee, we praise the name of our God. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's turn to number 6. Hymn number 6. Immortal, invisible, God only wise. Sometimes hymns are born out of awful anguish and tragedy. Perhaps the greatest have been given to us this way. The hymn that we're about to sing came out of much agony and great help of God. Perhaps the Reformation, in part, produced this next hymn. Perhaps the followers of John Huss. John Huss was burned at the stake. You'll notice when we look at it, it comes from the Bohemian songbook, out of the sufferings of Huss, but mainly out of the 30 Years' War came this hymn right here. The 30 Years' War reduced Germany from 16 million people to 6 million. There was a man by the name of Philip Spinner in Frankfurt, Germany, and in his congregation was the author of this song. He was a lawyer, just a layman. And after this awful time, you know, 30 years of war between Catholics and Protestants. And imagine 10 million people dying. But sometimes it takes great tragedy to bring appreciation in our soul. Oftentimes it's that way. Now in that context, this man wrote this wonderful song. He was a spinner, was the leader of the pietistic movement in Germany. You've heard us talk about Quakers in England, heard us talk about Quietists in Italy. Well, in Germany it was called the Collegia Pietista, or the Pietist. And here was a man by the name of Spinner who, because the church had really failed them, they were in war. Protestant church and the Catholic church in war. So he met with people in homes and little cells, and he read the Bible to them, and he encouraged them to look right up to God. So when the organized church had failed, this man, through the remnant, encouraged people and helped them. One of his parishioners received this inspiration and wrote this song for us, and that's where it comes from. So it's number 2. Sing praise to God who reigns above.
Praise the Lord.
Number 2.
Thank you, Jesus.
Seated, the sanctuary choir will come forward. I had another psalm in mind for Brother Larry to lead us, but I'm going to ask him to find the 35th chapter, I believe, of Isaiah, if that's the one where the desert blooms, and he can read that to us after the choir gets in place.
Pastor?
Yes.
Chocolate on ice cream.
Thank you, Lord.
It made the song better.
Oh,
and I want to thank God that you did that.
Oh, yes. Praise the Lord.
I said that Pastor Hope's sharing
Pastor Hoag's sharing before the song was like putting chocolate on ice cream. It made the song better.
Oh, wonderful.
So praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord. Hallelujah.
Pastor Hoag.
Yes. Yes.
I have to follow David, don't I? Anywhere he goes. Your sharing, of course, was like David said, but also there was secrets in there that if we listen closely, it covered questions we've had all our lives. It told you why the Crusades were there, and also told you why there was people there obeying God that we didn't have any idea about. I mean, I just when you talked about the conflict, then realized that there was people really walking with God at the same time. Explained to all the historians. My brother-in-law says, why did such and such happen, and why did the Crusades and all this? He's a historian. And I did not realize that, or did not think that under all of that, people were obeying God all along, and the name did not depict what was really going on. The name Christian and Catholic does not depict what really was going on. It was the two spirits of this world fighting against each other.
That's right. A.B. Bruce said, the real proof of Christ's blood in our lives is that we're delivered from legalistic worship. Mm-hmm. And so there's efficacy in that blood to take us from religious profession to a real work of the Spirit. He said, the writer to the Hebrews said, and I'll be mentioning this morning, that it's because Christ offered himself through the eternal Spirit. And the eternal spirit, see, the key spirit. Fleshly, legalistic, professional worship, there's nothing spiritual about it. And I got awfully excited this morning in reviewing the text that I preached a couple of weeks ago in Parker when I said, Jesus, they told me the songs. I said, Jesus, we're going to be worshiping in the
Lord.
Spirit.
Thank you, Lord. Yes.
Jesus said such a time was coming. The woman at the well.
That's right.
That made a way for America to worship him, not upon the mountain, or not in Jerusalem, but in spirit and in truth. So the joy of true worship. See, what's happening to us this morning is not type and shadow.
Mm-mm. That's the real thing.
And yet, nearly everywhere, that's all it is. It's not type and shadow. It is always type and shadow unless the Holy Spirit is led. And it's not any different than the sacrifice of goats and bulls and the sprinkling of the ashes of a heifer. That's all religious. That's all religion. It doesn't make any difference how exciting it is or whatever moves in the flesh. But when God's leading, it has eternity in it. Isn't that wonderful? So therefore, our worship to Him today is an acceptable sacrifice. Praise His holy name. I'm looking forward to this song, and I want Brother Larry to come and... Yes.
I want to clarify one thing.
Oh,
That brother-in-law was not the one on the front seat that I was telling you that said...
All right. Well, that's all right. I never thought it.
He may have thought that at one time, but he doesn't think that now.
Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Do you have that passage? I think it's wonderful that the Holy Spirit should... help pave the way in our expectations, lifting our spirits for prayer, that He would give us this song this morning. This is the scripture for this song, Brother Larry, is going to lead to us. And I think it's the 35th chapter of Isaiah.
It'd be better in NIV.
Well, whatever. It'd be good anyway.
Let me just try the invisible air day.
The desert and the parched land will be glad. The wilderness will rejoice and blossom. Like the crocus, it will burst into bloom. It will rejoice greatly and shout for joy. The glory of Lebanon will be given to it. The splendor of Carmel and Sharon. They will see the glory of the Lord, the splendor of our God. Strengthen the feeble knees. Steady the knees that give way. Say to those with fearful hearts, be strong, do not fear, your God will come. He will come with vengeance, with divine retribution. He will come to save you. Then will the eyes of the blind be opened, and the ears of the deaf unstopped. Then will the lame leap like a deer, and the tongue of the dumb shout for joy. Water will gush forth in the wilderness and streams in the desert. The burning sand will become a pool, the thirsty ground bubbling springs. In the haunts where jackals once lay, grass and reeds and papyrus will grow. And a highway will be there. It will be called the Way of Holiness. The unclean will not journey on it. It will be for those who walk in that way. Wicked fools will not go about on it. No lion will be there, nor will any ferocious beast get up on it. They will not be found there, but only the redeemed will walk there, and the ransom of the Lord will return. They will enter Zion with singing. Everlasting joy will crown their heads.
Once we're
you, choir. It's so good to hear you again. We look forward to it. Praise the Lord for the service to Jesus today. If you were here for the prelude, you probably are very happy. Dear Father.
Thank you, Lord.
That's part of the prelude, which becomes interlude rather than postlude. And I was looking at it here, I was just weeping. Because it starts without a song, and then it goes to On Silent Forest Path. And it says, Humans Why, which is so often given to us. Then you heard her play, You're My Best Friend, today. Country and Western song that's done in such good taste. It's a beautiful arrangement and a wonderful singer. But we turned it into a song because Jesus is our best friend. He really is our best friend. Lord's been speaking to our daughter, and He's been telling her, showing her that He's her best friend. That's what she told me yesterday. And here's the song. You're my best friend. Really appreciate that. By God's grace. Praise the Lord. Then it's Precious Lord, Take My Hand. Oh, that's the cry of our hearts. And then there's Chariots of Fire. I don't know if she's played that yet, but she just played Rachmaninoff's 18th variation from Rhapsody on the Thing of Paganini, and I remembered that both Brahms and one of the great artists had already taken that theme, so they didn't think that Rachmaninoff could do much with it. He did quite a bit with it, didn't he? I think he composed that in his little villa after he'd been exiled from Russia at out there in Switzerland somewhere, Luzern, I think. But oh, what an anointed piece. She's yet to get to Getting to Know You. Is that from the musical, Getting to Know You? Hallelujah. Well, I had an assignment here today. I'm just walking with Jesus. the best I know how, and you are too. But I'd like for, yes. Oh, yes. Certainly.
Earlier, my wife and I were in the classroom with Barry Doss, and something that I'd compelled a few thoughts, but one thing that I was thinking is that while he was saying that is I've never had any problem believing in God, but one thing that there's always been a little conflict with is, can he lead? Can we really have a close walk with him? That's been a struggle, thinking yes, no, yes, no, going back and forth on that. And I just now pieced something together a little bit ago.
Wonderful.
I started to stand up about 10 minutes ago and say something, and something wouldn't let me do that. I just kept sitting because I thought I had something to say, and I've chickened out before when I've had something to say and didn't say anything. So I thought, well, I'm just chickening out again, although I really want to do it. I don't know why I'm not getting up and saying something. And I realized there was something else I needed to piece together. And that is, when I sat down, I was compelled to open the Bible and just start reading right during the prayer.
Yeah.
And that may be unusual, but I just started reading. And I opened to the first page of Hebrews. And I'm not as familiar with the Bible as I should be. I'm, as a matter of fact, very unfamiliar with it. And I noticed something that was unusual to me, but maybe most people, probably most people in here are aware of. And that's that when I read that there was never mentioned the author or the group to whom the author belonged of the book of Hebrews. There's a little theological setting element in this Bible here.
Mm-hmm.
And I kept reading through the first page of Hebrews, and that just seemed very, just keep sticking out in my mind as I read through that.
Yeah.
But I kept absorbing the other things too. The next thing, also during the prayer at the beginning, I just put the Bible down after that first page and just opened up the little page here that Helen Rice had put in and started reading that.
Wonderful.
And the next thing I read, as I read down, it says, you've heard people talk about what their first act will be when they walk through the pearly gates. Some want to find out who wrote the book of Hebrews. And that's when I realized that I really did need to stand up and say something, and when I put the connection together. And I felt that there is some leading in here with us today.
That's right. It's beautiful. The writer to the Hebrews, for some reason, has been hidden from us, though in our translations it reads Paul in our King James. But I think it was by the design of the Holy Spirit that the real writer be hidden, in order that we should recognize that the Holy Spirit is one. He does all the writing, but most certainly we'd have to say that. And he worked so hard in the book of Hebrews to let us know that the Old Testament was written by the Holy Spirit. For he only mentions, I think, one author once, and that's David. All the rest is, and as the Spirit saith. And such a great thing. So God's working and helping here this morning, and we praise him. You see, brings such a satisfaction to my heart, because there's one amongst us that knows that God is leading.
Yes.
And that's the difference between valid and invalid.
Yes.
Difference between real spiritual worship and ritual, just ritual alone. Ritual hardens, and God has to deliver us when we get into a hardening position. But ritual will allow a measure of peace to the conscience in order that self-assertiveness may continue. And that's why you have so much of it throughout the land. I never said it before, never saw it, but there it is right there by God's grace and mercy. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Thank you, Jesus. True worship involves self-denial. Give God the praise and the glory. Hallelujah. Well, I found out I had a baby dedication this morning, and I was so thrilled. I'm finding out a few other things, too. I've got some dear friends here that are relatives of this child. So I want you to know, dear brother, while you spoke, the Holy Spirit operated with me.
How does that fit in here? Well, it fits in this way. In the home of the king, there was a girl, a young girl from Israel. She served the mistress in the home of Naaman, rather. She served her mistress, and it was she that said, if only my master would see the prophet who is in Samaria, he would cure him of his leprosy. Her name might have been Natalie. Whatever it is, we're praying this morning that the spirit that was in that girl will be in this one also. Well, sometimes usually I pray for the congregation first, but today we pray for her first. So we just pray for Natalie. Praise the Lord. Amen. Brother Barry, you may anoint her for this dedication.
Now to the grace, we anoint you in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Let us pray. Dear Lord, in the early morning hours, days ago, you spoke to this minister about this young girl. And when we came today, we found we had this dedication of either forgotten or just learned of it. And we thought, Jesus, what passage shall we use? And I remembered the blessing in the early morning hours of this great story. So, Lord, we bring to you today Natalie Grace Klein. And we pray that the spirit that was upon this girl would be also upon her. That she may, even as a little girl, even if she's in the prison of circumstances, point the way to perhaps an unbeliever, to the way to the servant of God, who knows the way of grace and the living God of Israel. We ask in Christ's name that thou would bless her and anoint her this hour, and that thee would cause all of us, O Lord, our Heavenly Father, to live in such a way that our lives would become channels, that this calling, that this responsibility, that this purpose in life would be fulfilled. Let her be one from a little girl who points the way to Christ through his servants, the prophets, who have been given the word of life and the revelation of the highway of holiness, and who have been given the grace, O God, that will heal persons of leprosy, which is a type of sin, both for bodily healing and for spiritual healing. Let her life be serve that purpose. In Christ's name we pray. We now dedicate you, Natalie Grace, to the Lord God Almighty, and we pray this anointing upon you this day. In Jesus' name, amen. While I'm holding her, congregation, if you will stand and respond by saying the Lord's Prayer with us, we'll be so grateful. Let us pray. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. You may be seated, congregation. Thank you for that response. I'd like to say today that this is your birthday, Keith? What a wonderful day to dedicate your lovely daughter. What a wonderful day, regardless, to pray that the spirit of this girl from Israel would be upon her. Praise the Lord. And you may watch me as I go around and I present her. These children suffer an awful lot. Sometimes I get to pray and they get in uncomfortable positions and they just do so well. And she's done well. Now, Brother Barry, would you get her presented over here? Amen. Praise the Lord. Oh, hadn't she done well? Hadn't she done well? Yes. Oh, yes. I present to you on her dedication day, Natalie Grace Klein. She presents herself. Natalie Grace Klein on her day of dedication. And to you, Natalie Grace Klein. Some children really enjoy their presentation. This one does. Natalie Grace Klein. And to you, Natalie Grace Klein. Praise the Lord. She's so pretty. I'll just take her up here. Pastors, Natalie Grace Klein. She's been interested in everybody I presented her to. And there, dear, are your musicians. There. Natalie Grace Klein. Praise the Lord. The day becomes more special through the years, and especially when we are privileged to look at the little certificate of dedication and also this little Bible. Praise the Lord. What a wonderful joy to be home and have this privilege today.
Thank you.
Hallelujah. God bless each of you. It's a joy looking at every face and all of your eyes. Wonderful privilege to have Helen and Karen here, isn't it? And I forget her name. Corey. Is she the one that loved me? When I, oh, yeah, she loves the prophets, but God's grace, I can see it in her eyes now. I had a wonderful time with her just a few days ago in Edward and Jackie's home. Praise the Lord. God be with you. Praise the Lord. Thank you, dear ones. Thank you.
In harmony with your joy, I want to announce that I'm glad that our pastor's back with us and his wife. Aren't you? It's great, isn't it? We've been looking for the day and we are blessed together. The Holy Land Choir will practice this afternoon at 4, but the adult choir will be canceled this week and next week as well. At Holy Land Travelers, there'll be a meeting in the music room directly following the service this evening. That'll be this evening. And Bill and Tina Light joyfully announced the wedding of their daughter, Angela, to Timothy Bishop on Saturday, October the 15th, that's next Saturday, at 2 o'clock p.m. in our sanctuary, and everyone is invited. And then her prayer request for Reverend Helm. Those who are able are asked to fast and pray 1 to 2 meals a day throughout the trip. Pray specifically that Brother Helm will be delivered in the area of the prostate, bowel, sickness in the stomach, and the brain and the soul. Pray that they will have good to excellent flights, good weather, and that all parts of the plane will work on takeoff and landings. And of course, for the trip in general, that God will just bless and use those who are going as He would have. These particular requests, though, if you'd like to remember them particularly, are found on a piece of paper like this in the foyer out here on the table, if you'd like to get that to know this particular request. And we know this trip is an important one because we're in the last days. And for God to be able to do what He would want to do is what we would pray. And that means, of course, that the enemy may not like that, but our prayers can make a difference. and bringing victory and bring the help that God wants to bring. Shall we take the offering? All right, ushers, could you come forward? Be our blessing to give unto God today, won't it?
Oh Lord, most of us this week have received paychecks, and we're very grateful. We're thankful that unemployment stands only at 5.4, and anything under 6%, the economist says, is almost full employment. We thank you for the longest extension of revived economy, I think, since World War II, and we're very grateful to be blessed, thankful for this area, which is particularly prosperous. But we pray for the pockets of poverty. We pray, O Lord, for those who do not have a regular paycheck or have just ceased receiving one. And we pray that in our lean times, our gratitude for God's provision will go up. We sanctify this, O Lord, for it is our love to Thee represented in tithes and offerings. We give Thee the praise for the privilege of worshiping Thee by giving in tithes and offerings. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. We'll be blessed as the Holy Land travelers to have Helen again this time. That's a great gift because
In the last five journeys, I guess we've been given the finest of, what do you call them? Guides. Yes. Finest of guides. She traveled all the way down to the waiting upon God to see us and was very thrilled with Brother Helm's message. Thought that he taught as the great rabbis, and was so thrilled with the light that she saw on the faces of the people. So she's looking forward to our coming and set aside another trip in order to guide us. And we'll be privileged also to have a guest out of southern Indiana who doesn't belong to Revival for a day, a friend of Tina's and Marion. You see his name at the bottom of the list when you receive it today. I think his first name's Emmett. And I'm praying that the Lord will help us and that he will guide us along the way, that our going will be a blessing to Israel. According to the itinerary, we are going to get to go to all the places, the normal places that are listed, and we're thankful for that, even to Bethlehem. So unless things change, we'll be in some wonderful places. We're doing something unusual. We're going to Galilee first this time, and there we'll spend, I don't think we've ever done that before, I don't remember, spend 2 days or 2.5 days before we go back into Jerusalem. So the Lord knew all that, and this made a way for us to go. I'm so thankful for your response. Probably Brother Helms never needed us more than he needs us now. He weighs only 154 pounds. That's what he weighed when he was 15 years old. And but his spirit is strong, and Jesus is really helping. But we just pray now for this miracle, because 4 times harder for him to think about this journey than any journey before. And he has dignity even when he's thin. See, I weigh 168, 169. He weighs 154, so, and he's 6 foot, and I'm 5'6". So you can see what a thin man he is. But when the second operation became necessary, then somehow it robbed him of the desire to eat a lot, you know. And we're thankful that while we were there, the bacteria disappeared, went out, and then he's receiving help there. It's not well in so many parts of the body. So we just pray that Jesus will heal him. It could be like Brother Morgan in 1970. Brother Morgan was 9 to 14 pounds below. I can't remember, somewhere between 9 and 14. And the Lord said, go, and he left looking very pale, very, very much well, concerned. Dorothy, who was living at that time, his wife, and Brother Helm prayed for him. And when he saw him, and every day he gained weight, and when we got at the end of the trip, he was right where his normal weight was, and he ate all the more because he enjoyed it so much, but that's all. It went right to the,
thank you,
just right up there where he belonged. Isn't that wonderful?
Yes, sir.
Jesus did that for Brother Morgan, and he'll be with us this time, and what a gift by God's grace and by God's mercy. Something happened to the choir when they were singing in the upper room this last time that tells me that this particular trip is very special, and I dare not speculate too much lest I get in the way of God. But Roger Yoder remembered it so well because he was crying so hard as a song, and the essence of it was, we're going to be different next time. And it says something about being one. We know that day's coming. So I would say that this trip is the most crucial in 23 journeys. And I'm very thankful for the representation from here. Very glad for your dedication. If you felt an extra fight, just see the battle Brother Helms will be in 1988. It makes sense. There's been an awful fight on. But we press near to the heart of God.
Amen.
Remember that I've been away 4 months, home only 2 weeks out of those 4 months. And I thought I would have to go back immediately after the trip. It was in, 2 or 3 days ago. And I remember going from the bedroom to the bathroom. I was in the hall, And I said, Jesus, let's sit. See, my whole life is geared to prayer there. And so I don't accept any invitations out when I've got to pray the next day. It means I can only go out on Friday night in the last 2 weeks, not that. Because if I lose a little sleep, then if I lose, well, I don't get much anyway. But if I lose, go past midnight, and I'm thinking about getting up, it may be 3 o'clock or 4 o'clock, and here, if you're going to pray hard like we do, I mean, we pray fervently. See, we pray hard. Well, it causes the body to ache, and the blood veins feel like they're going to burst. And you get in quite a place. If you're praying every day and preaching on Sunday, every Sunday at 8 o'clock, you gear the whole life. I became kind of like a monk in a monastery. Because in order to keep health, I only missed prayer one morning. I had not to do anything at night except Friday night, and that was canceled in the last 2 weeks. And then preaching on Sunday at 8 o'clock, you don't do much anything on Saturday. You just have to pray and wait and study. When you have a meditation from 8:30 to 9, you have the finest men in the world to speak to, then you have to be spiritually on top. So I began to live like my brother Terry. Go to bed by 8 o'clock, 9 o'clock, and awaken about 3, 3:30. And by the time prayer meeting came at 8, I had read 15 to 20 chapters in the Bible. I'd been in prayer, and usually God would give me something for my soul. And I'd take that right into the meeting. So the men around Brother Helm need our prayers, because they, in order to be very effective, they have to live the life almost as if they're in a monastery. That's what I found. And so I thought, now I was coming back to this life. That's what I started to tell you. And I hit the hallway, and I said, Jesus, I said, Lord, the leaves are turning green in West Virginia. I mean, they're turning colors in West Virginia. And I thought of a few more things. And I thought of you. And I thought of this beautiful sanctuary. And I thought of West Virginia. I thought of many things. I said, but Lord, it looks like I'm not going back. I've been, you know, to get your mind set, then to have it, you think you're home and you're not home, and then you're coming back and you think you're going home and you're not going home, and just certain things happen. Your heart opens up and you close it off and you look up and you just need help. You never know till you've been through this what it's like. And but I said, Jesus, I said, whatever you say, you know I'm sticking it out here if it's till I die. I said, the devil just wells give up. I don't care how if my flesh rots off, by God's grace, I'm staying right here. And I'm standing right like that, and suddenly I realized, I said, with all of my want-tos, you know, see, what God leads in involves self-denial. He says, all I want, I said, I'm at peace. I said, with the fact that I'm coming back, I'm at peace. And suddenly the scripture came, the God of peace shall sanctify you. Oh, I said, making difference what the swirl, or what the circumstances, or where I'm going, or when I'm coming up, the God of peace shall sanctify you. And I said, thank you, Jesus. Thank you. I was encouraged. Yes, isn't that wonderful?
Yes.
Praise the Lord. See, I'm older than I used to be. Dad says it's worse when you're in your 70s to get out of your nest. But it starts happening in the 50s, seemed like to me. But then I remembered something else. I said, Jesus, when I hit 50 years of age, I said, Jesus, isn't 50 long enough? Isn't it long enough, Lord, for a man? Shouldn't a man be sanctified by 50? Well, I don't know. It's fortunate if he's sanctified by 70. But I know one thing. He's been working differently in my 50 years. So I said, well, Lord, if you're taking me at my word, thank you. And thank you for a people that will back us in this endeavor. Praise the Lord. Before I share this morning from the 9th chapter of Hebrews, Jeannie's going to sing something that she may sing in Israel, too. She has before. Is that the one? Mary's song.
How could it be this baby in my arms sleeping now so peacefully? The Son of God, the angel. the Son of my love. Father, show me where I fit into this plan of yours. How can a girl be mother to the Son of God? Lord, for all my life I've been a simple handmaiden. How can I raise a king? How can I raise a king? He looks so small, his face and hands so fair. And when he cries, the sun just seems to disappear. And when he laughs, it shines again. How could it be? Could it be this baby in my arms sleeping?